Throughout the 20th century, doctors have made spectacular progress in repairing damaged humans. But now we're at a crossroads. What if they can improve on the original? Make new body parts that outstrip the ones we're born with. It's an idea that goes back to the very first work of science fiction, Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, written almost 200 years ago. It was about a scientist who attempts to build a superhuman. And ever since, science fiction has been exploring the fantastic and terrible consequences of tampering with nature in this way. But while the writers let loose their imagination, the scientists have been hard at work on the real thing. For better or for worse, Frankenstein is coming to life.
What we've seen in the 20th century is a culmination of man repairing man and recreating what is considered normal. As we move into the 21st century, we'll look at how do we augment man.
Joe Rosen rebuilds people. He's one of America's more experimental reconstructive plastic surgeons. And one of the first people he worked on was Mark Pauline. On the outskirts of San Francisco, Pauline constructs robots and earns his living by running a robot circus. Some years ago, while Pauline was rehearsing for one of his performances, the robots hit back.
I met Joe Rosen back in 1982, but I met him in conjunction with an accident that occurred here. I was building dangerous rocket motors for a performance. One of them detonated when I was handling it incorrectly. It blew all the fingers off my hand except for this one. They took two toes off my feet. This is a small toe from one foot. This is a big toe from another foot. They grafted them on. Dr. Rosen was involved in nerves that were taken out of my legs, and they were used to bridge the nerves in my arm to the nerves in my fingers. It's functioned perfectly since 1983, and I've used it and abused it.
Dr. Rosen doesn't only use organic parts to repair his patients. His toolkit contains mechanical parts as well. Eric Harper lost his original arm while working in a printing press. He controls his new arm by twitching the muscles that remain in his shoulder. The mechanical arm detects these faint movements and responds accordingly.
And it's strong enough, I can open the door enough.
Rosen believes that we are not far from being able to take these sophisticated repair technologies and use them to create new kinds of human beings. Joe Rosen's ideas have attracted interest from powerful quarters. He was recently invited by NATO to a conference on building a bionic man. Rosen says he was never told why NATO was interested in bionic humans, but he unveiled a master plan for their creation.
There are four categories of artificial humans. One would be a human made up of all human parts, with a human brain and a human hand. The other extreme would be a robot or an automata made up of a computer as a brain and mechanical parts. Then you can have two hybrids. One would have a computer as a brain, but a human hand, and the other would have a human brain running a robotic hand.
When I considered the improvement which every day takes place in science and mechanics, I was encouraged to hope my present attempts would at least lay the foundations of future success. It was with these feelings that I began the creation of a human being.
Frankenstein was the beginning of a long tradition of speculation in science fiction about how artificial humans might be constructed and what they might look like. One vision has proved to be especially popular. Science fiction's all-time favorite blueprint for the superhuman has carved a trail of destruction through countless movies and comic books. They're part man, part machine. They're cyborgs. The cyborg became part of popular culture in 1973 with the release of the TV series, The $6 Million Man. In the opening scenes, the hero, Steve Austin, has a plane crash. He is subsequently rebuilt with bionic parts. But this man claims that Steve Austin existed for real. 30 years ago, Martin Caden wrote the novel Cyborg, on which the TV series was based. Caden says that the fictional Steve Austin was inspired by a living person, a fellow U.S. Air Force pilot who was actually involved in a plane crash.
And everyone gave up right away. When the airplane hit, you just knew the man could not live. And when the thing finally came to a halt, the guy was still alive. They rushed him to the hospital, and they rushed the airplane to a second hangar. And the doctors then began to work on a man on the basis of, we have nothing to lose. Let's try every new advance we have in science, and medical science. And the man, instead of being crippled all his life, flew again. Flew the same airplane again. And I mean the same airplane.
According to Caden, this non-fictional bionic man continued as a pilot in the U.S. Air Force. And the entire episode gave birth to a military program to build cyborgs.
We had a cybernetics program that was started in 1970-71 and really got going in 1972. This program was based upon modifying the human being into a superior creature than one that was born normally. We developed the program. We were ahead of the whole world on it. And the cyborgs that were built at the time were all volunteers. And we just were stunned at ourselves. We knew what was coming.
No one has been able to confirm Caden's claims about the existence of a military cyborg program. But true or not, it seems that Caden's stories have been influential.
We have the technology for building devices that will allow a crude bionic man . The $6 million man program was an inspiration to some of us, I believe, to pursue this area. And specifically, what might have come from that? Well, our attempts which we'll be making in the next few months, to have an animal control a robotic arm directly with his brain won't be as sophisticated as the science fiction that we saw on television, but it's the same kind of thing.
For an hour a day, a laboratory monkey sits in this chair, playing a computer game. RC, as he's known around the lab, is going to perform a historic role in the creation of a real cyborg. RC plays his game in return for rewards of applesauce. But while he plays, a device deep inside his brain is being monitored. This set of electrodes has been permanently implanted in the area of his brain responsible for controlling his arm. When RC moves his arm, the electrodes detect activity in his brain and light up.
That's sufficient now to allow us to hook a monkey directly up to a control device on a robot arm and to teach that animal to move the robot arm to give him the kinds of things he wants. Raisins, peanuts, apple juice. You know, vodka martinis for you and I, that kind of thing.
This device is the key element of a cyborg master plan, a piece of hardware that allows a direct connection between the nervous system and mechanical parts.
Within 5 years, and maybe 10 at the outside, I believe that we will implant one of these devices in the brain of a paralyzed human volunteer, and we will be able to control stimulation of his paralyzed muscles so that his limb moves again, or if it's more desirable for that patient, to control movements of his own robot arm.
And once we've got that far, some interesting possibilities open up.
Superhuman body parts can be built. One can build arms that are much stronger than the human arm. And so it's conceivable that one could have brain-controlled devices that give one superhuman capabilities.
But to make a bionic man, you need not only the bionics, but also the man. And it seems that there are actually in existence groups of people who are queuing up to be turned into cyborgs.
I expect to have little artificial neurons implanted in my brain, which in the near term I think will allow me to augment my information abilities. And in the long run, I think will actually add to the brain to such a degree that this biological thing we have right now will be a minor component of what we do our thinking with. So eventually, I should be able to think with far more capability than any human being does today.
Max and Nancy Moore are the founders of the Extropians, a group of people waiting to be turned into superhumans. From their beachfront home in Los Angeles, they publish Extropy, a monthly magazine that details current scientific research into improving human bodies. They have some 5,000 subscribers.
Extropians are people who look at the human body and say, what an incredible marvel of nature this is, but can't we do a little bit better? After all, nature didn't have any intelligence, it didn't have any plan in mind when it designed us, so I think humans can do a little better. We can become something more than human by applying science and technology to changing the body into the form we want.
Mr. and Mrs. Smith, they are not. But then the first superhumans are going to have to be the kind of people who are happy to be wheeled into an operating theater and have mechanical components implanted into their perfectly healthy bodies.
I think we'll add to our visual capability, for instance, by rewiring the optic nerves so we can see in a broader spectrum. So at night we can see things by the heat sources, for instance, or look up into the sky and see things in ultraviolet. But maybe we'll better hide those inside our eyes, or maybe we'll have to stick something on the outside. We'll see what happens with that.
Max Moore's questions may soon be answered. Artificial vision is already being developed, but not yet as a fashion accessory for cyborg wannabes. Harold Churchy is completely blind, and he's volunteered to test a device that's being built at Johns Hopkins Hospital in Baltimore.
In the next 25 years, I believe we'll be able to produce a computer chip that will be placed into the eye that will restore visual function in about half of the patients that are considered legally blind at the present time.
How many fingers do I have up?
I don't know. Don't see either of my fingers.
Okay. Can you see what I'm doing here?
No, I can feel the air, the wind.
Okay. That's...
Dr. Dejan's science fiction vision is already under construction. The current prototype computer chip is going to be temporarily implanted into Mr. Churchy's right eye to test its performance. It's a grid of 25 electrodes which are connected to a power supply. The chip is inserted into the back of the eye through a slit in the side of the eyeball. Mr. Churchy is conscious, but feels no pain. The electrodes make contact with the nerve endings in the back of the eye. By connecting up the electrodes in different configurations, Mr. Churchy can be made to see spots of light in varying patterns. It's the only vision he's had for 7 years. In this particular trial, he saw colors and even shapes, but hasn't yet got as far as identifying what the shapes were.
A U or a circle?
You see a U or a circle?
Yes, I believe. That's about two streaks up and down, kind of going across.
Are the two streaks going the same direction?
They were, yes. It wouldn't be an H, would it?
That'd be a good one for you.
This particular type of prosthesis would work for a blind eye, but it would also work for a seeing eye. Theoretically, you could make an eye sensitive to infrared, or see in the dark, or see heat, or see a lot of things that we can't see now.
So will hospitals of the future be crowded with people getting their mechanical parts? There are some who think we'll get used to the idea. Since his accident, Mark Pauline has spent the last 2 decades living in intimate contact with robotic machinery.
Once parts are available to people and they're better than the parts that people are equipped with now, people will simply start using them. They'll start attaching these parts to themselves. I don't really have that kind of a paranoia about machines. I live with them, you know, every day. I'm dealing with them on a day-to-day basis. I live here in the midst of all this chaotic jumble of equipment, and You know, I hear them calling out to me on a daily basis, fix me, feed me. My wires are damaged. My controller needs replacement. You must help me. I have no qualms about replacing my body with a, you know, with a device as long as it was as good or better. Probably want to have eyes in the back of my head. Probably have a couple sockets here so I could have, you know, four arms. And if you could have four, I suppose you could have six.
Given the choice, I don't think anybody really wants a mechanical arm, even if it's stronger than an organic one. I mean, there are considerable technical difficulties in hooking them up to the nervous system, but I really think the infection risk is what's going to blow this off the map. Just think of the irritation you get when a contact lens goes bad, you know? I mean, this is one of the few mechanical prosthetics which is being used by a large percentage of the population. You get a piece of grit under there, or your life stops. Now imagine something which is like directly hooked up to, say, your spinal column, which has a very large number of pain receptors. You know, you're getting up in the morning, you're attaching your extra mechanical crab arms, and it's like, you know, something's gone wrong. You know, transistor burnt out last night. It's gonna be bothersome, like really bothersome, like worse than high heels.
Science fiction writers have upgraded their vision of the superhuman into something much subtler, something people might conceivably want to become. Mechanical body parts are taking a second place, because the ultimate material to work with is human flesh.
We have been constrained by our limitations for hundreds of thousands of years. These limitations are about to fall away from us like scales from our eyes. And I think what we see and what we do will define a new kind of human being. In the beginning, all we could imagine, we're adding mechanical things to our bodies because no one could really figure out how to do the organic changes. When science fiction started thinking about cyborgs, we didn't know the structure of DNA. It took people like Aldous Huxley, and then the science fiction stories and the magazines all started pushing us to think less about just plain mechanical add-ons to think more about the organic changes from within, where you'd actually change the being that you were working with so that they might not be considered purely a human being anymore.
Science fiction has long had another vision of what our bodies may become. Not cyborgs, but a super race. Super strong, super fast, super intelligent. And these beings won't look like mechanical monsters. They'll look like perfect versions of ourselves. And in science fiction, one technology in particular has traditionally been used to create this new breed of human beings. Professor Walter Gehring is a genetic engineer at the University of Basel in Switzerland.
We have created a fly with additional eyes on its legs and its wings, as well as its head. The response was very different. Some people thought scientists have nothing better to do than to create these monsters, and this is Frankenstein at its best, with the corresponding caricatures which appeared in the newspapers. On the other hand, there was a father who has two blind children and wants to support my research. We have isolated a master control gene from flies, which, when you turn this gene on in the wrong place in the fly, you can induce the formation of an extra eye on a wing or on a leg. And the astounding thing was that a single gene has so much power.
The red dots all over the bodies of these flies are indeed eyes. They are fully formed, but not connected up to the flies' brains. So, happily for their owners, cannot be used to see with. Professor Gehring has no immediate plans to take his work beyond flies. But the genetic material of humans could, in theory, be manipulated as dramatically as it has been for these flies.
In earlier times, before genetics were really understood, genetics was essentially fate. But now we can take, at least to some extent, we can take the genes into our control and decide about our fate.
I think we're going to modify our bodies. I think we're going to do it for the sake of our kids, because we're going to want them to be better. If we won't do it for ourselves, we won't try to stop them from being better. And the question then becomes, what kind of generation gap will we deal with when our children stop looking like us? When they have their own choices, they can stop being limited by their genetic variations. They can be handsomer than the material we gave them.
We've spent the last 200 years stocking Dr. Frankenstein's lab with exactly the technologies he may need. All that remains is to begin the experiment for real.
The rain pattered dismally against the panes. My candle was nearly burned out. When by the glimmer of a half-extinguished light, I saw the dull yellow eye of the creature open.
Science fiction has always had a love-hate relationship with the superhuman. It's fascinated by the wonderful possibilities of re-engineering the human body. But it's even more fascinated by the horrible consequences of doing such a thing. The stories reach the same conclusion. If we dare to play God, we invite catastrophe. The question is, will that stop us?
What I think you're actually going to see is a situation like a cocktail party, and a woman arrives, she's charming. She moves like a prima ballerina, and she's very good looking. And the men gravitate to her, and the women bite their lips in envy. And one looks to the other and says, you know, who is that who just came in? And I said, well, that's Agnes. She's been to Cyprus. She had some things done in the lab. And at that point, you reach a watershed. The person looks at that and says, well, what did she do and how do I do it? And not only that, but you can recognize that what she has is like worth selling your house for. That's when it actually hits, you see. That's when it begins to really permeate. It's like hitting people on an extremely intimate level.
Hollywood, spiritual home of the cocktail party. Every year, thousands of perfectly healthy people already pay to have their bodies surgically improved. They visit private clinics like this one overlooking Hollywood Sunset Boulevard. Their surgeons are people like Dr. Richard Ellenbogen. Ellenbogen performs many of the more radical operations, like this $25,000 forehead lift.
In Beverly Hills, in California in general, it's like taking your car in for a 40,000-mile service or a 50,000-mile service. It's expected. It's not looked down upon. And people realize just as they take their car in, they have it serviced regularly. If they have themselves serviced regularly and they look good, they realize that they'll function better because your image, the way you see yourself, the way you feel about yourself, determines how you function in all other facets of life.
It was interesting because on last week or over the Memorial weekend, I was at Wendy's house, who works here also, and she had a get-together. And almost every woman there had work done by Dr. Ellenbogen. It was, so everybody was very, oh, you're going to love it, you're going to look great, you're going to do this. So it was neat to get that positive feedback. Also to see all these women who had their work done and they looked great. So, but they didn't look unreal.
And in America, a quarter of a million people a year already have their bodies rebuilt with the best that science can now offer.
It will be done to suit normal ambitions by normal people. Eventually, we'll get used to it. People will get used to it in the way they get used to crossing the Atlantic in 8 hours or hearing the recorded voices of dead human beings, or watching videotape. I mean, these are all things which were tremendous violations at one point, just seemed outlandish and unreal. Well, to the people who are doing them, they won't be outlandish. The outlandishness will fade, and once it fades, then it will become a normal mass market technology. It won't be human, but it'll be very real.
Each human's going to want a different product, and the goal of the physician is to help that person build on themselves into that human they want to be. It's a very individual thing. And I think as we move forward in the 21st century, we're going to see people becoming more and more specialized as individuals than we've seen before.
And when Rosen talks of building specialized individuals, he has a future in mind that goes somewhat beyond cosmetic surgery.
With respect to artificial humans, we're at a beginning point. We're at the point where we've realized that we can build a bionic arm that resembles a human arm. We built the early stages of man-machine interfaces where we can interface between the nervous system and a machine. We've started to dig away at the genetic code and molecular biology to try to understand how do we deregulate somebody so that they regenerate a new arm. We've seen notions of this and we've experimented with it to get close to it, and we can foresee a future where all these things are possible.
There will be such a thing as an artificial human being, and they will walk among us, and they will be us, and we will be them. And they will not allow themselves to be called artificial beings, and nobody will call them that because they won't look artificial. They're going to look glamorous.
The story of the superhuman is the oldest in science fiction. It reflects our deepest desires to be stronger, faster, smarter, more beautiful, to be better. Even though science fiction has warned us against meddling with nature, the signs are that we're going to do it anyway, and sooner than you think. Next on Future Fantastic, weird science. From invisibility to telepathy, how scientists are reopening the files on some of science fiction's wildest ideas.